spent a lot of years in this business, traveling the world on somebody else's nickel. It's a phenomenal business to have somebody pay you to go on vacation to Europe, to South America, wherever you go. So the opportunities here are fantastic, and I suggest that each and every one of you take advantage of those opportunities, not only the broadcast curriculum, but, you know, in whatever part of the audio world you end up being. I grew up in Ogden, Utah. Somebody else is from Ogden, Utah here. We went to the same junior high school, I just found out. How awesome is that? Holy crap. Grew up in Ogden, Utah, and I wanted to be a musician, so I started studying music at a very young age. And when I met real musicians, I thought, man, I really suck, so I'm done. But I wanted to be in the music business, so I started getting into the engineering aspect of it. And so I was working in a couple of small studios in Utah. I actually worked with the Osmonds for a while. I worked with Marie a lot. And, you know, I kind of got tired of doing the music thing, you know, being the midnight track guy. That's not always fun, you know, when everybody walks in and, you know, they're all wound up and ready to go and you're in the middle of your sleep cycle and it's like, oh, man, what am I doing here? But so I decided to get into broadcast television. I kind of fell into it by accident. There was a company called Video West in Salt Lake City, part of KSL. She knows that. I'm going to point to you a lot. You're going to be in trouble a lot tonight. Should never have told me that. So I started doing some Utah jazz games early on in my career, and then CBS came to town, and their mixer had gotten sick, and they were doing a skiing event, and I kind of got tapped to go up and try to mix a skiing show for a network. Do you know how odd that is, working for a national network instead of, you know, a little Salt Lake City TV station? So I went, and I guess I did a pretty good job because they started calling me to do their shows for them. I was working at Video West at the time, doing their post stuff, and decided to quit my job and go freelance in 1985, and I haven't looked back since. Let's see, what else? So I started working for CBS as a full-time freelancer in 1985, and I did 10 Final Fours with them straight, not as a mixer, but as support, working myself up into the mix position. And my mentor, a guy by the name of Bob Siderman, who was mixing the Madden Summerall crew at the time, saw something he liked in me and kind of took me under his wing. So I was his project. So each and every one of you are going to have somebody that's going to take you under their wing, and you can be somebody's project. I've had a lot of projects, and I love it, because that's the only way we succeed is by people having projects and helping everybody out. So I started mixing for CBS pretty much full-time. And in 1994, Fox got football. We took it away from CBS. Well, they took it away, and I was the first freelance hire at Fox Sports, or one of the very first freelancers at Fox Sports. And at the time, I was with what is called the B Crew. I was mixing the B Crew audio. And my mentor, again, Bob Siderman, was with Madden Summerall, and unfortunately, he got sick in 1997 and passed away. So they passed the torch on to me. So I started working with John and Pat, and I was with them for 5 years. Doing that show, and I'll tell you what a great, iconic show to work with. I mean, John Madden, Pat Summerall, for those of you who don't know football or anything, John and Pat, they were the guys. So once I had gotten with them, that, you know what, I had done something for myself, and it was a pretty neat situation to be involved with. And so I was with them in 2001. Until then, when Joe and Troy came on board with us, we changed A Crews, John went off to ABC, Pat retired, and we got NASCAR. And NASCAR was, what a wild sport that was. I had done some NASCAR up until that point with CBS. I'd done a few Daytona 500s with them as a submixer and audio support and all that. But Chairman Hill pretty much gave me a blank sheet of paper and said, I want it better than it's ever been before. So we pretty much changed how everybody listened to NASCAR, which was awesome. And for the first time, we had a segment called Crank It Up, which no network had ever asked their announcers to sit out and just listen to the sounds of the event. So we made a big splash with that. So to ask talent that makes millions of dollars a year to sit out and not talk was pretty incredible. So that was kind of fun to do that. So Crank It Up was born about, what was it, Brock, 7 years ago? 5 years ago? Seven? I had met Brock. He had asked me to come and do a lecture like I'm doing tonight, or kind of BS you guys or whatever it is we're doing here tonight. I'm not sure what that is. But we started talking about broadcast audio, and Brock knew nothing about broadcast audio. In fact, nobody at the conservatory knew anything about broadcast audio except, you know what, you turn your TV on and it works. Well, as you well know, it's kind of like putting a record on and going, ah, great, the mix just happens, right? Well, there's a lot of work that goes into that. So I had taken Brock and Mr. Ham to an NFL game back in New York, and they were hooked. They saw what it takes to actually put a football game together, to put a remote together, what I go through in the control room listening to a producer, a director, an associate director of my audio PL trying to do a mix, and having the pressures of 100% of the country watching your show. So if you kind of screw up, everybody knows it. It's not like sitting in a control room where you can go back and say, hey, you know what? I didn't like that mix or that take or that segment or whatever else, so we're going to go do it again. The neat thing about live television, when it's over, it's over. I go home and I sleep very, very well. The thing is, if you screw up, you're not going to sleep well at all. So, you know, it works both ways on that. I'd been given a lot of opportunity early on in my career by a lot of people, and I wanted to give back. So that's why I came to the Conservatory and I started talking to Mr. Ham and Brock about how do we put together a broadcast curriculum for the Conservatory. It seemed to work out well for me because through all the cycles that you guys do, you know, signal flow, you're learning about microphones, how they act, how they react, how mixes act, how they react. You learn to deal with talent. My talent is a little bit different than your talent. You know, these guys are seen on TV by millions of people every weekend. You know, you have people you hope to work with are selling millions of albums. So there's kind of a, you know, they work hand in hand together there. So once I convinced Mr. Ham to look at a broadcast curriculum, it worked out really well because nobody I see really coming up behind me. I'm going to retire here fairly soon. I don't see a lot of people coming up behind me in broadcast audio. We still need mixers. We still need people to do what we do and go out and get in the trenches and, you know, travel and go around the world, which it's not for everybody. But for some of you, it might be something that, you know, you'd like to do. So it was my mission to kind of give back. And so we talked him into a broadcast curriculum, and I'm doing my part, I hope. Brock's doing his part. Mr. Ham's doing his part just a little bit. Thanks a lot. It's the last time I invite you to New York. But I've been very blessed in my career. Again, I've worked with some of the greatest sports announcers in television, John Madden, Pat Summerall. I'm with Joe Buck and Troy Aikman now. We just finished our game last weekend in Carolina. I don't know if many of you are Cardinals fans and watched the game. The game really stunk, but the audio was awesome. we had a great weekend. So I have mixed actually every Fox Super Bowl that we've aired except the very first one, which my mentor Bob Siderman mixed, and I was his sidekick on that. I've done 12 Super Bowls. I've been to 6 Olympics, many World Series. I did Final Fours. Did a lot of Final Fours in Indianapolis. I have an Indianapolis guy back here. Spent a lot of time in Indy. About the only thing that I really haven't done is I haven't done any IndyCar racing, which is fine. I've done a lot of NASCAR. Last year was the first year I've missed the Daytona 500 since 1998. So that's a pretty good run there. What else? I mean, my gosh, it's hard to say. I'm kind of sitting here trying to think, man, I'm getting old if I've done all this crap. But it's kind of neat to have you know, to look out in the audience and see all of you hopefully have a desire to do something great with your careers. Again, whether it's in broadcasting, which how many of you ever thought that there was a lot going on in broadcasting? Most of you thought that it's just, all right, he wins. You get a quarter when I finish. Turn on the TV and it just happens. You know, that's what everybody kind of thinks. You turn on the TV, it just happens. It's kind of like when people turn on the stereo. The music just happens. Well, it doesn't. There's a lot of backline that goes into that. And I think once you get through the 10th cycle and you start seeing some of the things that we're doing, I don't know how many of you have been through 10th cycle yet or not. A couple of you. So you kind of know now, just hearing and listening to a few things, that's a little different than sitting in the control room with a producer by your side and going, oh, let's back that up. Let's do this, this, and that. Man, when it happens, it's gone, and you got to be there and be on top of it. Otherwise, you're unemployed. And I like to see everybody employed, so it's a great opportunity for you to learn. And Brock and Corey and Eli, have taken over the program and have done just a phenomenal job with that. Woo! Exactly. And Eli was Instructor of the Year last year. He doesn't like that, but, you know. So we're kind of happy to have him in the broadcast curriculum with us, but those two are doing a great job as well as Brock and Jeff Harris and everybody getting everything kind of up to speed and all of that. So it's kind of new for the Conservatory as well to teach broadcast because they've just been into live sound, doing the music recording thing, gaming audio and everything. So this is just another tool for you to go out and find a job. And I think that's the what we want everybody to do is, I like to see people employed. I like being employed. I like money. What can I say? I like to be employed. And I think that's what all of you want to do is get employed and have a good job and everything. So, you know, it's a great opportunity to look into broadcasting, you know, if you'd like to, you know, I say when your music career doesn't work out for you, and for a lot of you it probably won't, and I'm sorry to say that because it's just the nature of the business. Mine didn't work out for me. I was lucky that I found something that I moved into. It's just another perspective and avenue that you can get a job in. You know, I mean, there's so many different perspectives in audio now that you can do. You're not just stuck doing tracking sessions or mix downs or post audio or anything. There's a lot of opportunity out there in broadcasting. You know, let's take Phoenix, for example. We have 6 television stations that do live shows at 4 a.m., 6 a.m., 8 a.m., 9 a.m., 11 a.m., noon, 5, whatever else. Times that by 6, that's a lot of people that they're starting to use. To where I think in town you have, 3 recording studios that are working right now? Maybe 4? So you take that, Tucson has TV stations, Phoenix, Flagstaff, you know, up around there. Look at Los Angeles. You know, San Diego has at least 8 or 10 TV stations. Los Angeles has 8 or 10, San Francisco. So opportunity in broadcasting really is, there's a lot of opportunity there to be had wherever you go, wherever you grew up. I'm sure you watch TV at home. Everybody has a local news station or there's sports going on there. Phoenix is one of the few cities that we actually have 4 professional sports teams. We've got hockey, we've got baseball, we've got basketball, and we've got football. Plus, we have 2 new universities, ASU, and then the guys down the street at U of A, which we pull our people from here to go down there to do the shows. So there's just a lot of opportunity in broadcasting if you look at it. So, you know, that's something to keep in the back of your mind when you're going out and you're doing your career and looking at things.